felt that it would be useful to use the next 40 minutes or so to look at some theoretical threads, what others have already said about the things that we have been talking about. And this, I felt, would be extremely useful for us to think about programmatic directions, policy directions, conceptual directions, ethical directions, and also kind of withdrawn to a reflective space to get the vocabulary. I think part of the struggle is also to understand, you know, when all our vocabulary is somewhat taken away, you know, when change, IT for change and change.org seem to overlap, then how do you make sense of change? Actually, it's somewhat of an epistemological crisis, if you will. So permit me to take you through some theoretical stuff. I think it will be useful. If it's not, then you can give me a bad rating in the afternoon session. But I think it will be useful. So this is something that a Finnish philosopher, I think he wrote this book when he was very, very old. So by then he had become extremely pessimistic, and he was not necessarily a feminist. But I really thought this summarizes for us some of the dilemmas that are present in our analytical frameworks. I think many times we are so reluctant to admit that we are already part of a kind of an emerging paradigm. We believe that all that is false, that we have control over our mobiles. I think a lot of us were dishonest when we said in the first day that we can do without our mobiles. And some of us were honest. We said, no, we can't do without our emails. We can't really put it down. Because like Janvi said, it is a net that nets us, you know, at some level. So the scholar has said that post-local man is able to transfer from one culture to another at will, from one history to another, to listen to the folk songs of all peoples, to organize different wedding rituals during his lifetime, to provide himself with a variety of ethnic experiences, temporary perfection. I think this is really important because if you look at all our lives, we actually go in and out of spaces. And despite our, beseeching announcement as to don't look at your mobiles, don't look at your computers, people have been doing it. That's because we want to wander into spaces and come out of spaces. We are present at many places. We want to download old songs from the YouTube. We want to look at rap. We want to look at mishmash and everything. So experientially and ontologically, I think we've become extremely complex human beings. And that is something we need to understand, without denying that not all of us on this planet still have access to gadgets. It is another matter whether everybody on the planet is connected or not. I think the two are two distinct things. So this is actually very, this is an Indian artist whose image I found on Pinterest. And the artist had given this name to his work of art, which is called No Time to Think, which somewhat captures the anxiety of our times. We all have an anxiety to stay connected. And what Prabir said the other day was rather fascinating, that there was an era which was the Orwellian anxiety of you're being watched by Big Brother, to now the anxiety that why nobody is looking at my photos and why nobody is liking me. And we also know that a lot of young people in the middle class and maybe even in the lower classes in peri-urban areas of people who have mobile phones, younger people, the anxiety to be connected and to be given attention to. You know, my photo, was it good enough? You know, take another photo, let me post this. Every day changing your display picture and all of that. So I would slightly qualify what Param said on the first day about the social condition of the internet. I think we should call it the social condition of the network society. Now, of course, everything is continuity and discontinuity, and I don't really think that we are particularly talking about some altogether new paradigm as if, you know, we are a humanity inhabiting a very different world which is far more special than civilization ever enjoyed. That's not the intent, but certainly to say that there is a certain transformation of temporality and spatiality because of the internet, and there is a time-space compression. So you can be here, you can actually do a video conferencing of this talk, you can actually be sending an SMS on the mobile phone, and you can be doing all of this at the same time, which is on account of the affordances of technology in terms of connectivity, mobility, and interaction. So what really happens, the phenomenon that is happening because of which one is able to compress time and space, Akanksha, you have to hurry, is deterritorialization, which is the weakening of the impact of physical distance on our everyday life because of the advent of cyberspace and time-space convergence. It may also refer to the weakening of territorial identities characterizing the rise of network space. Now, we need to understand, and this is something very exciting, a lot of us have been talking about blogs, we've been talking about women in panchayats, marginalized women. When they actually take to the online space, even if they were illiterate, finding an identity online somehow seems to be so liberating, so emancipatory, simply because their localities, being embedded in their territories, is so oppressive that till they discover oppression online, at least, till that fleeting moment, that experience of being online gives you the possibility to revel in the identity that deterritorialized space confers upon you. So it's not as if you're somebody online, somebody offline, but your identity online is able to give you a particular deterritorialized experience. And that is what is actually happening to us. Which leads us to what philosophers, every second word they use is called, is ontology. So don't be stumped by it. It basically means being, you know, the state of being. What happens is there is a tremendous fluidity in the way we are. So that fluidity is manifest in the way we work and play, live and love, which is the blurring of the public and the private. This has also come, I mean, everybody has spoken about it in your presentations. Why? And I wanted to give you a very interesting analysis that I read somewhere, that if Facebook, you know, if you're Facebooking and you're online and you're saying something, and the analysis that we've heard in the past 2 days about Facebook treating you as a product because it's going to sell your preferences to advertisers, and Facebook is profiteering from that model, then what you're doing is offering your labor to Facebook. So far clear? Yes. Then the next philosophical question is something that we've never thought about. Then is what you're doing work or play? Isn't that profound? So you are online. You think you're generally like linking up and connecting. But what you're doing is actually labor in the traditional Marxist framework for the capitalist who is expropriating the labor, right? So for someone, what you're doing is labor. But for you, it is play. So I think these categories complicate our lives. I can go back.
No.
All right. Stop me anytime. So I think from the social condition, we come to the human condition. Now this human condition has been captured, the human condition in the age of networks has been captured by many scholars, the dada of which is Manuel Castells, whose Information Age trilogy, if you haven't read, then you should at least read the Wikipedia entries, because these days we all read bytes. So what Castells says is, our societies are increasingly structured around the bipolar opposition of the net and the self. The net denotes the network organizations replacing vertically integrated hierarchies as the dominant form of social organization, which means from thinking of organizing and control like this, you have to think of organizing and control like this. And the self denotes the practices a person uses in reaffirming social identity and meaning in a continually changing cultural landscape. So the whole, I mean, in this time-space compression, there are these networks which are about interconnections and interactions, and the self is constantly reinventing itself to relate to this set of interactions. Now, another French philosopher, Bruno Latour. So, ontologically speaking, to have has become a stronger definition of oneself than to be. So we want to have friends, we want to have profiles, we want to have relations. So that is becoming a more dominant form of the human condition. So the thing that I wanted to move on to is, I'm okay here, thank you. Deleuze, again another French philosopher. So it is undeniable. There is something that has changed about the human condition which is intertwined with the machine. It is intertwined with silicon chips. It is intertwined with digital networks in such a way that we are assemblages. This is a very interesting word. It actually means that we are not one thing, but we are a thing that is constituted by our interactions with machines, by machines here, digital paraphernalia, or digital apparatuses, at every moment. So, I can't even begin to think of the innumerable machines I'm linked to at this point in time. I'm standing here, I'm linked to this presentation, I'm linked to this microphone, I'm linked to that video camera, and I'm linked to possibly other mobile phones, which may be recording my speech, etc. Yeah, I could be tweeted from this room, and the military establishment might come after me after this talk. So, the body is considered as an... So this assemblage, with Deleuze actually spoke about it in 1994. So like quite forward thinking. One asks what its effects are. I think the whole viscerality was mentioned by Sharada Muralidharan, I mean yesterday, which I found a very important expression, that the entire domain of sensibilities, how you make sense of the world, is completely changing. And I remember what Aditya said the other day, that for me, linking to the people that matter, I can't do it without my emailing. I mean, today the way you live is that set of assemblages, and your emotions being affect, the word affect for those who may not know, is crudely referring to emotions and experiences. They have become really, really important. They need to be foregrounded. And in an assemblage of the way I am now, linked to all these, you have to understand how they can or cannot enter into composition with other affects, with affects of another body. So somebody else is linked in some other way, and we are all connecting as human-machine assemblages. Bodies cross paths, connect and change. From the perspective of affects, the question is not, for example, about the effects of the internet on a person. Gone are the days when we should be looking to causality and linearity when we are understanding phenomena. I mean, you said the industrial age brought this, blah, blah, electricity brought this, the steam engine came, and therefore Britain colonized India. There is no linearity now, because when you're actually thinking of the internet and people, thinking of digital technologies and people, you're looking at connections that mutate in very different ways, and that is the way one must understand the human body, the human condition. So this hybridity can be understood in three different ways. I'm just summarizing what was said. Technology is not autonomous. It is integrally connected to the context in which it is developed and used. Culture is made up of connections. And technologies arise within these connections as part of them and as effective within them. So we are actually talking about a coherence, an integrity, a whole, which is not a distinction between woman and machine, but essentially woman and machine being co-constituted. Which brings me to Donna Haraway's Cyborg Manifesto. If you haven't seen it, please see it. She wrote about the Cyborg Manifesto in the early 90s. And at that time, she really felt that finally emancipation had arrived. I think she was not able to think of how advanced capitalism will take over the universe once again. But you have the Cyborg Manifesto. If you want to dream, then you can. So there is, in the context of, therefore some scholars have called it post-humanism, the whole condition where this hybrid kind of existence is leading to a post-human context. And this is a scholar from the UK. He has a very interesting, his book, Post-Humanism, is a very recent book. So there is always this thing that the human body was inscribed. So let's take slave trade. Slaves used to be tagged with different things. Even in the Jewish concentration camps, people used to be given numbers. Now, there's a very, very weird take. That was one kind of history where the body was marked. Now, biometrics is, something else is happening in biometrics. It does not insist on inscribing the surveillance body with a number. So you're not like called and given a number. What it actually does is it decodes what is already inscribed in the body and then identifies it as belonging to X or Y structure or class or population. This is why it's so creepy. It's actually creepy. So in the old times, branding used to cut into the skin. So it used to code you. It used to say, you are a black slave, right? And you are the property of the white man. But biometric is just something that Pramod refers to as epidermisis, or brings to the surface of the skin, which means it decodes. So that iris thing is something that you already have, right? So it's not like it's giving you some iris color. You already have iris color. It is just surfacing it. And in that way, there is a new form, which just by knowing, I don't know. But if people know how genetics works, every human being by their DNA structure is different, right? So in that sense, each of us can really be decoded in extremely singular and different ways, right? So that is why it's so creepy, because this is the new biological citizenship in which biometric data from within your body determines your bio-value to the organization, society, or nation, which is what Prabir was saying. If they wanted to go after you, they could go after you, right? Now, the example that Pramod takes, I'm very grateful to him for, which is a UID example. Now, what he says is, if you read the document, and I was really wanting to go and read the UIDIA document, which is written with an ideological slant, and I'm sorry I haven't got the quotes here, but you can certainly go back and read in Google Books. He says that the way, ostensible reason why all this is done is to, you know, reach your food grains to the poor, get better health care to the poor, etc., right? But the way it's written is, it is precisely because no identification methodology existed that hunger and healthcare, you know, could not be dealt with. So the ideology actually completely shifts the terms of the debate. You're not able to stand up and say hunger or, you know, abolition of hunger is a human right. So the terms of the debate, I mean, this is very insidious, you know, if you really look at it, the terms of the debate completely change, and all of us in this kind of existence in the eyes of the state become these hybrid post-human characters. Now, the economic aspects that were already discussed, and I wanted to share with you a research done by a Swiss-based organization, and I just spoke about the body, now I'm talking about the economic sphere. There is a network of global corporations that controls the world. And they run the world. These are a mere 147 corporations, and this was done by this research agency, and just like Kamyani, I also went and verified, you know, whether they are a think tank that is independent, etc., etc. They are an independent research think tank, and as researchers, they were curious to know which are the big companies. So they plotted all these and did some big data visualization, and they arrived at these connections, and they found that 147 guys run the world. And they're a group of tightly knit companies. But when they did another layer of analysis, they found something that is really horrific. They found that all of the ownership of this particular intimate group of corporations was controlled by another superset, which held 40% of the world's wealth. Which basically means that this is really looking at from a financial stability angle. If you really looked at it, what it means is, if something went wrong with one of these companies, you can be sure that at least 40% of the rest of them will also go bust, right? This means that the world is now standing upon on the top of a capitalism, which is so fragile. It's so fragile that our production is not really sustainable. The way production is sought to be accomplished in the post-industrial era is not at all sustainable. So what, and how are they able to do this? They're able to do it because contemporary neoliberalism deploys the material substrata of the digital commons. And that's what I think Sejal and also that Kamyani was also saying, that people really come to it with an opportunism and deploy that opportunism also too, as many of you have pointed out, to go after, I think Sumandra also said, if you have open data, be very clear that open data is not going to be used by citizens, civic groups and all. The companies are right after that to know where the natural resources are, where are the mines, and you know what more can be raped out of the face of the earth. So that's the way productive capacities of societies is being expropriated. Now, can you see something very tiny there? Yes. That's, yeah, for those with good eyesight, it's culture. And then they came for culture. So I think that the final, in some sense, of the final horizon of contestation for all of us is there is body, there is this economic domain, and then the control actually is perpetuated by this kind of psychological, socio-psychological slavery that all of us are part of, right? I mean, the net that nets us is an abstract entity, but I mean, it is us and we are that, you know, in some sense. And these enclosures in those days, in the 16th century UK, you know, when you spoke about grazing lands which were enclosed, at that time, people went for, you know, the feudal landlords tried to encroach upon grazing lands in the commons. But today they operate on something larger, which is a planetary scale, which is human civilization, which is culture and knowledge. So it really doesn't matter at some level, you know, what Venu said is really very important, that it doesn't matter how many radio stations there are, but how many of them have the consciousness that they don't have to ape the FM radio. You know, those FM radio, sorry to you, I mean, I don't mean to sound derogatory, but the kids who speak on that are like, you know, the same style. So in some sense, the way we ape culture is such a kind of imperialism that it's a kind of a project that finalizes everything. And here, the role of new intermediaries who profiteer without capital is very critical. And there is a very moving story. There is a friend of mine who started a special cab taxi service in Bangalore for the disabled. And her taxi service actually has a chair that comes out, you know, so she has to buy one of these sedans and then, you know, remove that front thing, and then you have to, and she re-engineers it, and there are some people who do it for her, and she runs some 4 cabs or 5 cabs she has. Now, these, she really wanted, I mean, coming from this social background and all, she wanted to also run an enterprise that is slightly viable, you know, in the longer term. So I took her file and all and went to this consultant who does enterprise, something it's called portfolio something consulting and all that. So he said, look, you know, basically I never consult for this kind of thing. The future is in asset-light businesses. Basically means become change.org. Agar paisa kamane ka hai, to become change.org. So become an intermediary. So today, if you put money into something, you will be seen by venture capitalists as fools. I mean, why put money, employ people, ko janjat sab kyo karne ka? And then later I found, she told me and she came and spoke again about other cab models, you know, which are, to which she's linked. And who are those asset-light models? Taxis for sure. Have you heard of this in Bangalore? Taxis for sure. Who apparently register all these small cab operators. And they have this dashboard and they've invested only in this software. And then after that, keep on directing each of these people to different locations because they operate on the aggregation. And once they operate on the aggregation, it basically means that they take a cut on every cab. And so the intermediary makes the money. Why does all this matter to feminism? Network capitalism as the final frontier of the commodification of life and of the valorization of the masculine dream of the unencumbered individual. We all want to be unencumbered, and that you know, we don't want to be linked back to community. In some sense of locality and community, there is a deep crisis with that. So there is a reward of enterprise over labor. Labor today, you know, is increasingly informalized, and therefore you have to be an entrepreneur. And many of the programs for women's empowerment are in the name of set up SMEs, you know. How will women set up any viable SMEs, I have never understood till today. But the whole thing is to set up SMEs. And the very architecture of market as society, which is, if you see the BOP modeling of microfinance, I don't know, some of you may have understood the model. Many of these companies simply extract the surpluses. go ahead.
What is an SME?
small and medium enterprises. So the whole thing is the surpluses of women. How can you take away the surpluses of women? You just land up in Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka and wherever. And also microfinance is seen by the banking sector as a very, very booming advantage, because 25 years, a lot of women's movements like Anandi and all and KMBS have done the good work of organizing the SHGs now. They just have to be tapped. I mean, the good work has been done. And you know, on a very asset-light model, you just do an software thing and go up and say every week. And it, how does it work? It works on collective liability. You don't even have to bother with the individual woman. Bol do sabko ki collective liability hai. Har somvar ko if you don't give the money, then the whole collective is doomed. So 10 rupiah dene ka hai to dene ka hai. You know, it is like that. So the entire thing is women's backs and lives, expropriation of collectivities, and the formal subsumption of women's labor into the logic of capitalism. So you just like, it's a clean sweep. And let us look at national data regimes, which is complete state impunity. And this was a point that had come up yesterday, day before, in at different points, which is, this is a point somebody asked. What is going to happen to the information that is being collected? Who? Where is the data protection order? You know, what is the data protection system? And Sumandra said, right, I mean, this is not even a law. It is an, you know, it's just set up under a government order. This UIDIA and all of that, because the whole, in fact, Nandan Nilekani in his report said that why we must do it is it's so efficient, because after the data is with us, we can do various visualizations and sell it to the industry, and that can really, you know, fuel the economic growth of the country. So, I mean, it's our data, it is government's money, and the data will be utilized by the market mechanisms. Now, I found this very interesting. It's pretty long, but I wanted to actually say that the complexity of ethics is a kind of a epochal anxiety that keeps coming back. You know, when the steam engine came, and the television came, and the telephone first came, you know, everybody thinks that, boss, I mean, the world is changing, sab kuch hil raha hai, so something has to be done. So in 1890, somebody actually said that, you know, cameras have come. Now, cameras have come, and they continue to haunt us, but there is a moral point, which is, now, why I found this very interesting is because I really found that from a gender analysis point of view, I would completely disagree with this. The thing is, it says that privacy is central to dignity and individuality of personhood. Privacy is also indispensable to a sense of autonomy, to a feeling that there is an area of an individual's life that is totally under his or her control, an area that is free from outside intrusion. I want to turn it on its head. I think for a woman, autonomy is about belonging to the public. Let's not understand privacy for a minute. I mean, privacy, of course, is very, very vital, and nobody understands the woman's privacy. She can't even pee in peace. But if I were to construct an ethical question, I would associate the notion of autonomy with women's public participation. I would say public participation is vital for a woman's autonomy. And many people here would agree with me. So in a sense, I think the ethical dilemmas are very contextual, and they need to be understood in an extremely gendered sense so that we know where the trade-offs exist. I'm just going to talk about two ethics. And I really found that much more than the ethics of information, which I found very limiting. You know, info ethics is a discipline, and a lot of people are doing research on that. I found the ethics of memory slightly broader. So how do you bring the ethics of body and memory, the devil in the data? So from a feminist standpoint, I think that there is an obligation to remember. There is a right to be forgotten and all of that. But there is an obligation to remember, because women really, really have shaped communities, they've shaped tribes, they've shaped nations, they've written histories, and they have actually, you know, the biosphere of human relationships actually women have reproduced. And so from a traditional knowledge, commercialization and copyright point of view, aajkal anything, no, yoga can go online and somebody can say this is power yoga, that is this yoga, this is aesthetic yoga, and anything can be branded. However, the way traditional knowledge is being taken away, and I was at a commons related seminar at JNU, and the scholar who spoke before me, she has been, Sumi Krishna, she's been working in the area of commons for a long time. And she gave this bizarre example. Ki Pupul Jaikar ke time pe, after Nehru, you know, there was this bard and all that, lot of drought. And suddenly, you know, sitting in the Department of Culture, she had this idea with Nehru that a lot of women from the tribal areas, if only their Madhubani paintings could be put on paper, handmade paper. Khadi Gramodyog was also set up and somebody needed to give it business also. So they made handmade paper and all, and they wanted to marry these two ideas of Madhubani paintings. So initially Madhubani paintings were only done in the walls of homes. Then this was in the era of the 70s. So tourism ke liye it started getting done, and you know, it cottage industry and all that. And then what Sumi Krishna said was there was a kind of a public interest case in the court. In Delhi, she says, there are so many women who are merrily doing Madhubani paintings and all of that and selling it online. And they're like you and me. So now, what is the ethics of this traditional knowledge that some people can commercialize it, and when the state deems it fit, it can be removed out of the walls of homes and put on papers? And what about the women actually who are still struggling, you know, with or without the paintings? So in some sense, I think the obligation to remember is really important, because the very first time, like Kamyani's work will tell you, and I don't know how many times she used the word in her presentation, write about it, write about it, write about it, which basically means, I mean, in some civilizational sense, we have bloody had the first, sorry, Parch, that, had the first opportunity for women to write their stories. I think that space to write your stories cannot be taken away. Then there is a duty I think women have, and others also have, men also have, that you have to rewrite history. There is so much misogyny that you have to keep on the business of erasing memory, bad memory. That who will do? Somebody has to do it, right? So, yeah. And this leads me to the thing that we are all bothered about, and many of us said this, right? Click, click, and then ho gaya. This always on connectivity and the depoliticized post-feminist subject. Ki, you know, get out and, you know, have your body be marked, you know, let the police take you away. How many of us can do it, right? I think that complicates everything, that who is a political activist, you know, that itself gets very complicated, and that is very problematic from the point of view of memory. Because what you receive in the form of an understanding in this current neoliberal, digitized, networked environment is that this is activism. Actually, many people think that is activism. Online kuch kar diya, that is activism. So that leads to this tremendous problem all of us have in our own programming of, you know, this time that takes to cultivate that sense of politics from within. I want to go back to Bruno Latour, and I want to give the example of Google. You know what? Google wouldn't exist without collective wisdom. What does that mean? You know, people who spoke yesterday, and I was feeling that this gap needed to be bridged. It's not as if, Roshni pointed out that algorithms is generating something. It's not like machines have, it is the assemblage. It is not that machines have their own memory. It is by the practice of the use of online space that we are generating data which is then mined by the company, which then generates patterns, which basically means that how does Google know how to customize or personalize your first page is not based on you alone. It is based on certain patterns that have been generated, which basically means that if you are a singular human being assemblage, and if there is collective memory in the form of data, then between the data and you, there need not be only one kind of relationship. Remove Google. Can there be another kind of relationship? Can actually that collective wisdom be harnessed for many other things? So that is the kind of, I think, the silver lining that Prabir was also talking about. The other ethics, other than the ethics of memory, I want to talk about is the ethics of locality. And I think this is the most complicated thing in our lives. We don't know what to do about the women who can't buy a mobile phone. We don't know how to theorize about them within this network society context, etc. Because we think we have access, they don't have access. But after the UID project and all, and, you know, at least after these 1.5 days, I'm sure somewhere you're thinking that maybe, you know, they are also connected. Even if they don't own a gadget, they are also networked. Now, so this global networks in the production of spaces abstracted from locality. So what has globalization and digital technologies done? It has completely abstracted the possibility to create spaces outside of territorial locality, yeah? But what is place? So this is a feminist geographer, Doreen Macy. and I find her work very interesting. She refers to, and we need to have alternative imaginaries of places, right? I mean, Param was talking about this research we did through our partners in Southeast Asia. And if you look at the completely atomized domestic labor in Taiwan and Hong Kong, all of them are coming from Bangladesh, Indonesia, Philippines, etc., etc. And they're all living in domestic households of their masters, you know, New Age masters. Now, the thing is that they have to connect back to their families. The mobile phone actually is so important for them because it gives them connectivity to others like themselves in the same country, and it gives them connectivity back to their own families. So for them, actually the phone is more than a gadget. It is actually access to a particular space. So, I mean, I think that's so self-evident that we understand now that these are just particular moments. Places are particular moments intersecting in social relations. And not all of these need to be face-to-face, and co-presence is not needed, that my body doesn't have to be next to your body. No place is only global or local. Global is in the local, in the very process of formation of the local. And therefore, the identities of places have been rendered highly unstable. So I don't really know if this group is only the group that met in Delhi in this particular USA establishment, or is it also a Google group, or is it the advocacy group that will be born tomorrow? It's everything. And these are all, I think, different identities that get formed with these digitized global flows. And I come back to this thing that there are singularities and multiplicities. There is a single identity, and then there is data. And there is no linear causality. So how does all this connect to democracy and governance? I think that enough has been said about the problematics of citizenship, about the problematics of lack of global governance of the internet, the deficits that we see, the crisis that we see in this kind of runaway market power, etc. But I just wanted to simply summarize that one very important area is the area of poverty governance, which comes in the name of development policies. Right? It actually today increasingly combines the aggression of market principles with extremely sexist paternalism. And I find this Give Women Mobile Phones projects really blah, because there is this, and the same thing about monies for SMEs, because it's like you, and somebody was saying, right, in one of the presentations that people were given in Akhilesh Yadav's regime, I think, laptops like that, and then the poor actually didn't know what to do about it, and so they sold it to somebody else. So the whole idea that you can redeem people by distributing technology is part of this culture of poverty governance, and this really is terrible because it's from the UID project to everything, it is completely disciplining democracy. So you really, like, you discipline, and in disciplining democracy, some of us are more equal than the others, so we live in the illusion that we can get away and not register with the UID, because anyway we can buy our organic jam that has been originated in the pristine hills of mountains of Switzerland in Bangalore in Jayanagar. But for the others who need grains, then they have to go to UID, right? So that dichotomy exists in the whole disciplining of democracy, and this is the ideology of netarchy. And the commons, unfortunately, our vocabulary has been taken away, and all this collaboration, all this, you know, there are so many corporate foundations now that you don't know between the foundations that, and their actual businesses, you know, where are they actually doing business? I mean, I know of a scheme where one of the information agencies that gives free information to farmers, you know, takes subsidies from a scheme from government, and for the, they say we'll do a pilot, paise de do, take from government, and during the pilot they take government money and they send free SMSs. After the pilot is over, anyway people are hooked to your SMS, so then uske baad take money from them month after month for the information you, it's ridiculous information, weather based information and something else which they anyway download and see, market price information, which anyway they don't generate. The government generates the weather based information, or maybe an international agency, and the government is generating mandi bhav. You see those and keep clicking and just come on. So what are the feminist issues? Where are women in the immaterial commons? Immaterial commons, commons of knowledge, commons of information. How do we reconceptualize theories of body as it becomes a site of expropriation? Sharing and collaboration are no virtues in and of themselves. I think microfinance companies are also collaborating with SHGs. And so all our words, cooperation, solidarity, democratic governance, I mean, how do we link it to justice? It's not just simply talking about collaboration, etc. And how do we recover alternative forms of production, gift economy, different conceptions of the life world? So we also need to really fight the copyrightization or proprietization of everything that is called information. So I think for the exercise that is scheduled, we really need to move to a new ethics of materiality. And we need to understand the spectrum got spoken about. I was really glad it came up. There are three layers which got spoken about in the first couple of days: the physical layer, the logical layer, and the content layer. In fact, even spectrum, although it's invisible, can be seen as a material space. And how do we really reappropriate all these things? You know, the physical layer, which includes cable, spectrum, wires, fiber, logical layer of software, as well as the content layer of information, knowledge, culture, everything. And how do we actually have a new ethics? So I will spare you some of these things, but I think it's really important that we need to think of local informational networks at the local level, which are built on top of ethics, where the primary purpose is not to mine data, but to create robust economies. And these are old dreams, actually. The old dreams are coming back because we always thought a cooperative framework is possible. We built our women's groups, their federations, their collectives on the principles of collaboration. Now, there is a possibility that you can actually give them alternatives for political empowerment, economic empowerment through the material layers of the information age. And I think we have spoken about these, net neutrality, public policies for competition, basically treating access as a right, a human right, access to information, access to the gadget, in fact, as being a precondition for accessing information. And promoting, and somebody pointed out yesterday, I thought that was very interesting when your presentation came, that you said in the days that you had to watch television, some public service content used to be on a ticker, something you had to perforce listen to, right? I mean, I am old and ancient, so Amchi Mati, Amchi Mansa used to come, like you had to sit and watch, like in Maharashtra, you know, farmers 7:30 program. So you had to sit and watch it because it was all organized like that. You couldn't surf between channels or anything like that. But how do you now generate that public content in this kind of attention economy where, and the filter bubble, both, you are going after TRP ratings and people are making you watch what they think you should be watching. Unless this domain of our local content, Khabarlehriya type of things, things that are happening, Chhattisgarhi and all of that, unless that domain can expand and assault our senses in a very emotional sense, you know, we are not going to be able to topple this kind of capture. And I really wanted to end with, you know, going beyond anxiety and what people, I think, very foolishly have said, is an ethos of becoming digitally imperceptible. That is, can you escape this net, maybe not, but I think temporarily at least you can.